الله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. وإن عليكم لحافظين كراما كاتبين يعلمون ما تفعلون. صدق الله العلي العظيم. صلى الله عليك يا رسول الله، صلى الله عليك يا رسول الله، صلى الله عليك يا رسول الله، ولعن الله قاتليك. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. An accusation has been made recently. It's not a new one. Previously and usually made by the opposing sect, the famous accusation of why did Imam Ali alayhi salam not return things to the way they were in the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi, if the so-called khulafa, the so-called leaders before him, done so much wrong, and if they changed so many things after the death of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi, the Prophet. If so many things were changed and so much bid'ah and innovation was made after his time by these so-called leaders, namely Abu Bakr, Umar, and Uthman, why didn't Imam Ali alayhi salam put things back to the way they were? If us, as the Shia of Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam, claim that he done everything the right way, and that they messed a lot of things up, and Imam Ali alayhi salam, his time was the time of righteousness, and his leadership was the best leadership, and everything happened the way it should, as he was the leader. So why didn't he put things back if they were put wrong in the first place? Or quite a few things, maybe not everything, but some things weren't put back to the way they were in the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So this is the accusation. And there's a list actually of things that were committed by Abu Bakr, Umar, and Uthman that we are getting blamed for now, because they say Imam Ali alayhi salam made no effort to change them. So that means you, the Shia, agree with what's happened, and you're just telling us that they were wrong things, but if had they have been wrong, Imam Ali alayhi salam would have changed them. So we're put in the same category as the opposers, the Bakris or the so-called Sunnis. Anyway, this accusation is quite easily answered by one of Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam, by one of his sermons, again in Nahj al-Balagha. And the title, I think it's a sermon about Tawheed. Sometimes it's quite hard to find because of the different copies of Nahj al-Balagha, but it should be something like Khutbatun lahu alayhi salam fi tawheed khatabaha ba'da insirafihi min Saffin. And you should be able to find this sermon. It's quite a long sermon, and it's all about the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and it's a very beautiful one as well. I advise that you read it or listen to it from start to finish. But the bit that we're interested in is right at the end, where he answers this accusation and he gives us the reason of why things weren't changed back. So he says, after, this is towards the end, after the long start of the sermon, he says, لَقَدْ عَمِلَتِ الْوُلَاةُ قَبْلِي أَعْمَالًا عَظِيمَةً خَالَفُوا فِيهَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ sallallahu alayhi wa alih. The so-called leaders before me, they done great things, or great disastrous things we can say. they opposed the Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. Amir al-Mu'minin alayhi salam says that the people before him, the so-called leaders before him, clearly opposed the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. He says, خَالَفُوا فِيهَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهُ وَآلِهِ مُتَعَمِّدِينَ لِخِلَافِهِ. They purposely opposed him, just in case people think, oh, it was a mistake or whatever. They thought this was the right way, so they went about it. He says, مُتَعَمِّدِينَ لِخِلَافِهِ نَاقَضِينَ لِعَهْدِهِ مُغَيِّرِينَ لِسُنَّتِهِ. He says they changed the whole sunnah, the whole way of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. وَلَوْ حَمَلْتُ النَّاسِ. This is the important bit. This is one of the most important parts in answer of this accusation. وَلَوْ حَمَلْتُ النَّاسَ عَلَىٰ تَرْكِهَا وَتَحْوِيلِهَا عَنْ مَوَاضِعِهَا إِلَىٰ مَا كَانَتْ تَجْرِي عَلَيْهِ فِي عَهْدِ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَآلِهِ لَتَفَرَّقَ عَنِّي جُنْدِي حَتَّى لَا يَبْقَى فِي عَسْكَرِي غَيْرِي وَقَلِيلٌ مِّنْ شِيعَتِي الَّذِينَ عَرَفُوا فَضْلِي وَفَرْضَ إِمَامَتِي مِنْ كِتَابِ اللَّهِ عَزَّ ذِكْرُهُ. He says, if I were to change things back as they were in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, there would not be anyone left in my army except for just a few of my close ones. And he carries on to say, and he says, a few of my close ones that believe that I'm an actual imam, not just a political leader. I'm an imam chosen by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَفَرْضَ إِمَامَتِي مِنْ كِتَابِ اللَّهِ عَزَّ ذِكْرُهُ وَسُنَّةِ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَآلِهِ. I'm not going to translate everything word by word. Maybe one day we need to stop at every sentence and translate everything literally, because it's quite important. But we've got quite a lot to go through and the lecture is short. So inshallah we'll pass through quite quickly. He says, عليه السلام, أَرَأَيْتُمْ لَوْ أَمَرْتُ بِمَقَامِ إِبْرَاهِيمَ عَلَيْهِ السَّلَامِ فَرَدَدْتُهُ إِلَى الْمَوْضِعِ الَّذِي وَضَعَهُ فِيهِ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَآلِهِ. He's going to start to list things one at a time. And we may not read all of them, or we may not translate all of them, because there is quite a few. Basically, in this one, he says, Umar ibn al-Khattab, alayhi la'natullah, he put Maqam Ibrahim, alayhi salam, he put it back to where it was in Jahiliyyah. So he says, if I were to put it back to where it should be, وَرَدَدْتُ فَدَكَ إِلَىٰ وَرَثَةِ فَاطِمَ عَلَيْهَا السَّلَامِ. And the story of Fadak is quite famous. I don't think it needs any explanation. But he says, if I were to return Fadak to its rightful place or its rightful people. Again, another thing. وَرَدَدْتُ صَاعَ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهُ وَآلِهِ وَمُدَّهُ إِلَىٰ مَا كَانِ وَأَمْضَيْتُ قَطَائِعَ أَقْطَعْهَا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَآلِهِ لأقوام مسمين لم تمض لهم ولم تنفذ ورددت دار جعفر بن أبي طالب إلى ورثته وهدمتها من المسجد. Quite a few things. A lot of it he's talking about distributing lands and the rest of it. And then he talks about the house of Ja'far ibn Abi Talib alayhim as-salam. And he says, if I were to return this to his sons, or to his waratha, to his the people who would take it after him, he says, if I was to return this and take it out from the masjid, because they had put it in the masjid, another list. وَرَدَدْتُ قَضَايَا مِنَ الْجَوْرِ قَضَى بِهَا مَنْ كَانَ قَبْلِي. And a typical example of this, he says, I will put back rules to the way they were, rules such as, for example, the cutting of a thief's hand, because you're not actually supposed to cut the whole hand of a thief. And obviously there's a lot of things, and there's a lot of things you have to go by before you carry this out. There has to be a certain amount of witnesses, and you don't cut the whole hand, you only cut the fingertips. Umar ibn al-Khattab alayhi la'natullah cuts the whole hand. So this is what we're seeing these days, especially in this so-called ISIS and the rest of it. If they see someone who stole, they don't go by anything that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has ordered them to do. They don't care about how many people witnessed it. They don't care about where they cut his hand. It's just monstrosity all over. And this is all made by Umar ibn al-Khattab. So he says, if I was to put these sort of things back to the way they were. وَنَزَعْتُ نِسَاءً تَحْتَ رِجَالٍ بِغَيْرِ حَقٍ فَرَدَدْتَهُنَّ إِلَىٰ أَزْوَاجِهِنَّ وَاسْتَقْبَلْتُ بِهِنَّ الْحُكْمَ في الفروج والأحكام. This is another disaster. He says, if I were to give back the wives to their rightful husband and order them in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's quite complicated, but typically he's talking about, for example, if a woman was divorced by bid'ah, if she was divorced the wrong way, for example, her husband will say to her, you're a divorce times three, just like that. In one instance, he will say to her, you're a divorce three times. The opposers, the so-called Ahl al-Sunnah, the Bakris, they would say this is a valid divorce and that's it, she would be divorced from him. Then she would go on and she would marry someone else. So this second husband that she's married isn't actually her husband because she has not been divorced properly from the first husband. So Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam is talking about this sort of instance. So what he will do in this case, he will say to her, this isn't your husband that you're with now, you need to go back to your previous husband. So this is a big issue. He's not going to be able to do this without running into a lot of problems, and he's going to say exactly what the biggest problem will be. Because people won't take these sort of things lightly. You can imagine someone who thinks they've done things the right way and they actually think this is their husband now. And then Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam will come and he'll say, no, this isn't your husband. All this relation that you've had with him is haram. You need to go back to your first husband and he's no longer your husband. And they were divorced in the first place, so they're not going to be the best of friends. So you can see how hard this is for Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam. He would still have carried it out, but you're going to see where the problem lies, the reason why he didn't. وَسَبَيْتُ ذَرَارِيَ بَنِي تَغْلِبْ وَرَدَتُ مَا قُسِمَ مِنْ أَرْضِ خَيْبَرَ وَمَحَوْتُ دَوَاوِينَ الْعَطَايَا وَأَعْطَيْتُ كَمَا كَانَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَآلِهِ يُعْطِي بِالسَّوِيَّةِ وَلَمْ أَجْعَلْهَا دُولَةً بَيْنَ الْأَغْنِيَاءِ. He said, I would have just distributed things to the rich and poor very fairly, exactly how Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi used to. Had he have been able to do this, had no one have opposed him, we would have had none of this poverty that we've got these days. That's why when we say every single wrong that has happened is because of Umar, Abu Bakr and Uthman, we mean it. Because it's literally true. Had they have not stood in his way and had they not changed all these things and forced people to follow them in the way that they did, Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam would have been able to carry out things exactly how Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi intended to, and none of these problems would exist. وَسَوَّيْتُ بَيْنَ الْمَنَاكِحِ. And this is a problem that carries on till this day. He says, I would not have made favoritism in marriage. So a rich can marry a poor, poor can marry a rich, and so on and so forth. And a typical example of this these days, you've got, for even with us, the Shia, it's not a great thing to mention, but it has to be said. A typical example is when someone is a Sayyid, when they are a descendant of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, they don't want to marry someone who isn't a descendant of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. They say, no, he has to be, otherwise I'm not going to marry them. And there's quite a few examples of this. And you've got different communities, they take it even further and say, and they say, if he's not from this tribe, then I can't marry him. This is a poorer tribe, or this is not of the best tribe, so I'm not going to marry him. All of this should not exist. You should never base marriage on these things. If the person is good, and they care about their religion and they care about pleasing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that's it. That's all there is to it. وَأَنْفَذْتُ خُمْسَ الرَّسُولِ كَمَا أَنْزَلَ اللَّهُ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ وَرَدَدْتُ مَسْجِدَ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَآلِهِ عَلَى مَا كَانَ عَلَيْهِ وَسَدَدْتُ مَا فُتِحَ فِيهِ مِنَ الْأَبْوَابِ وَفَتَحْتُ مَا سُدَّ مِنْهِ. What does Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam mean in this? First of all, he says, I will return the khumus, the 20%. I will return that to the way it was at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. And he's going to go on to explain this a bit better later on. And he says, I will close, وَرَدَدْتُ مَسْجِدَ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَآلِهِ عَلَى مَا كَانَ وَسَدَدْتُ مَا فُتِحَ فِيهِ مِنَ الْأَبْوَابِ وَفَتَحْتُ مَا سُدَّ مِنْ. There's a few doors that were closed after the death of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وآله, and a few doors that were opened opposite to how the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام وعلى آله أفضل الصلاة والسلام, they were closed and opened opposite to how he had it. So he says, I will return these, I would have returned these to how they were had I have not been opposed. And another example of this is obviously the door of Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salatu wasalam was opened at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, and all the other doors were closed. This is what Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi has ordered. وَسُدَّ الْأَبْوَابِ إِلَّا بَابُ عَلِيٍّ عَلَيْهِ الصَّلَاةُ وَالسَّلَامُ وَحَرَّمْتُ الْمَسْحَ عَلَى الْخُفَّيْنِ. He says, this is another one of Umar's handy Islamic shortcuts that he made for the Bakris, or the so-called Ahl al-Sunnah. He says, I would have banned the wiping of the socks during wudu. Before you carry out your prayer, you have to wash your hands and face and etc., etc. And obviously us, the Muslims, the followers of the Prophet and his pure family line, we do not wipe over our socks because we know we were ordered not to. If you want to wipe on your feet, first of all, some of them don't even wipe their feet. They wash their feet, completely opposite to what the Quran has ordered them to do. The Quran says, امسحوا على رؤوسكم وعلى أرجلكم. امسحوا, مسح. المسح in Arabic means to wipe. And if you look at some of the translations that the opposers have of this verse in the Quran, when it says امسحوا على رؤوسكم وعلى أرجلكم, they've put in brackets, I don't know where they've got these, the brackets of Abu Huraira, they put wash. So they weren't brave enough to put wash your head and wash your feet, but they've put in brackets just to verify that it's not part of the Quran. They're not trying to change the text of Quran, but they've put in their nice little brackets, you need to wash your feet, just in case someone decides to go back to this verse and say, hold on a minute, maybe we shouldn't be washing our feet. He'll say, oh look, but they've put these brackets here, so that means we must wash our feet. Just as simple as that. No explanation, nothing. Just, you've got your nice brackets, you need to wash your feet. So this shortcut, unfortunately, made by Umar, a lot of our opposers follow this till this day. You see them when they do wudu, they do their hands and face and whatever, and then they wipe their head. And then they go and just wipe over their socks. And then, لَا صَلَاةَ لِمَنْ لَا وُضُوءَ لَهُ. There's no prayer to him who has no wudu. So then their whole prayer is unaccepted because of one thing. And the likely chance of it is it's going to be because of a few things, because a lot of things they do in wudu is wrong and a lot of things in salah is wrong. But regardless, because of this one thing, their whole prayer would not be accepted. Says وَحَرَّمْتُ الْمَسْحَ عَلَى الْخُفَّيْنَ. I would have banned this bid'ah, this innovation by Umar ibn al-Khattab. وَحَدَدْتُ عَلَى النَّبِيذِ. He's still listing the things that he would have done had he have not been opposed. He says, if I were to punish the people who drank nabith, was an alcoholic drink, that one of Umar's most favorite beverages that he could not leave even till the moment of his death. وَأَمَرْتُ بِإِحْلَالِ الْمُتْعَتَيْنِ. Another big problem, I don't think it needs any explanation. Everyone knows Zawaj al-Mut'a these days. It's probably the number one topic. He says, I would have ordered for Mut'atayn to be halal. And Umar ibn al-Khattab, he says, Mut'atan, he admits himself, Mut'atan, كَانَتَا فِي عَهْدِ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ. I don't think he says sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, but كَانَتَا فِي عَهْدِ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi وَأَنَا أُحَرِّمْهُمَا وَأُعَاقِبْ عَلَيْهِمَا. He says these two mut'a, they were in the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, but I have made them haram. I'm the successor of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. The so-called successor. I have made them, I'm the so-called successor and I've made them haram, and I will punish whoever practices this. Admittingly, he says, مُتْعَتَانْ كَانَتَا فِي عَهْدِ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهُ وَآلِهِ. They were in the time of Rasulullah. But I have the guts to change them and to tell people that yes, they were, and I will change them. Subhanallah. وَأَمَرْتُ بِالتَّكْبِيرِ عَلَى الْجَنَائِزِ خَمْسَ تَكْبِيرَاتِ. I think Umar has made it four takbirat. So he says he would have put it back to five takbirat. So when there is a janazah, Like at a funeral, when there's a body, he will do takbir, he will say Allahu Akbar 5 times. Umar ibn al-Khattab, I think is Umar that changed this, he put it to 4. Anyway. وَأَلْزَمْتُ النَّاسَ الْجَهْرَ بِبِسْمِ اللَّهِ الرَّحْمَنِ الرَّحِيمِ And told people to say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim in a loud voice or in a heard voice, a voice that someone standing next to you or in the same room will be able to hear you. This is another thing that we're ordered to do by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi and by Amir al-Mu'mineen. The Bakaris don't practice this, the so-called Sunnis. وَأَخْرَجْتُ مَنْ أُدْخِلَ مَعَ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَآلِهِ فِي مَسْجِدِهِ مِمَّنْ كَانَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ أَخْرَجَهِ وَأَدْخَلْتُ مَنْ أُخْرِجَهِ Let's translate the first one because it's quite important. I think he's talking about the lovely scent of Abu Bakr and Umar that is now with, unfortunately, with the Prophet صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَآلِهِ. He says, I would have taken out Umar and Abu Bakr because they were buried in the same land as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He says, "Had I have removed them, had I have removed he who Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has removed." So Amir Mu'minin alayhi salam says that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has removed these two, but they have been put back. So if I was to again remove them from the masjid, and then he says, "Mimman kana Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam." أخرجه وأدخلت من أخرج بعد رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله ممن كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله أدخله. And I think in this instance, perhaps he's probably talking about either himself because they closed his door, or maybe he's talking about Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, because he wasn't buried in exactly the same place that he was ordered to bury. One of the two. وَحَمَلْتُ النَّاسَ عَلَىٰ حُكْمِ الْقُرْآنِ وَعَلَىٰ الطَّلَاقِ عَلَىٰ السُنَّةِ And told the people to follow the rules of the Qur'an and to do divorce in the way of that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi has ordered. So none of this, oh, you are divorced times three, like we're some sort of school kids, divorce times three, divorce times four, and everyone's just multiplying divorces, and there's all these people marrying someone who is not really their husband, and all these sons of adultery, unfortunately, because the mother and father aren't really married, and all these problems. And of course, Umar ibn al-Khattab, alayhi la'natullah, has planned this very well, because he's one of the soldiers of Iblis. So he knew that Ya Ali la yubghiduka illa ibn zina. So he thought, okay, if Ali ibn Abi Talib, if the only people who do not like him or the only people who hate him are the sons of adultery, then let me make some sort of innovation to make a lot of sons of adultery, so we'll have a nice son of adultery army and we can overthrow Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam. So this was the plan of Umar. Unfortunately, looks like it's worked quite well. وَحَمَلْتُ النَّاسَ عَلَىٰ حُكْمِ الْقُرْآنِ وَعَلَىٰ الطَّلَاقِ عَلَىٰ السُنَّةِ وَأَخَذْتُ الصَّدَقَاتِ عَلَىٰ أَصْنَافِهَا وَحُدُودِهَا Perhaps he's talking about the way you take sadaqat, because there's only certain forms you can take it. For example, dates or cow or the rest of it, or dirham. All the rest of the ways that sadaqah can come in. وَرَدَدْتُ الْوُضُوءَ وَالْغُسْلَ وَالصَّلَاةَ إِلَىٰ مَوَاقِيتِهَا وَشَرَائِعِهَا وَمَوَاضِعِهَا And had I have returned wudu that you do before salat, والغسل, the washing, and the prayer itself, had I have returned all these things to its times, مَوَاقِيتِهَا وَشَرَائِعِهَا وَمَوَاضِعِهَا to all its times and its right places, if I was to return all these things to the way they were, the list is nearly finished. وَرَدَدْتُ أَهْلَ نَجْرَانِ إِلَىٰ مَوَاضِعِهِمْ I think Umar kicked the people of Najran out. وَرَدَدْتُ سَبَايَا فَارِسِ وَسَائِرِ الْأُمَمِ إِلَىٰ كِتَابِ اللَّهِ وَسُنَّةِ نَبِيهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَآلِهِ If I returned the captives of Faris to the way they were, سائر الأمم إلى كتاب الله وسنة رسول الله. So basically, he would use the rules of Allah and sunnah Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi to put them back because they were captives. Idhan, this is the reason. So he says, had I have done all these things that I've just listed one at a time, idhan latafarraqu anni wallah. So if I would have done all these things, everyone would have separated. لَتَفَرَّقُوا عَنِّي وَاللَّهِ لَقَدْ أَمَرْتُ النَّاسِ أَنْ لَا يَجْتَمِعُوا فِي شَهْرِ رَمَضَانِ إِلَّا فِي فَرِيضَةِ. He goes on to say, I have ordered people to not gather, to not do Salah Jama'ah in the month of Ramadan unless it was for a prayer that is wajib, a prayer that is a must. Not a bid'ah prayer that you just make up. وَأَعْلَمْتُهُمْ أَنَّ اجْتِمَاعَهُمْ فِي النَّوَافِلِ بِدْعَةٍ. And I told them that these gatherings that you're doing is a bid'ah, is an innovation. فَتَنَادَى بَعْضُ أَهْلِ عَسْكَرِي مِمَّنْ يُقَاتِلُ سَيْفُهُ مَعِي. And a few people would have started shouting, a few people of my own army. So you know the people that were with Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam, they weren't the Shia of Amir al-Mu'mineen. Most of them, they did not submit to Amir al-Mu'mineen as an imam, as a person chosen by the Prophet, chosen by Allah, by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. So they did not submit this. They just thought he's the leader. And you know, Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam didn't even want the leadership at the time because he knew what was going to happen. He knew these people asking for his leadership are just fed up of what's happened previously. They tried Abu Bakr, they tried Umar, they tried Uthman, and Uthman was the final straw. Uthman was the feather that broke the donkey's back. That's it, they had enough. Because Abu Bakr and Umar, they changed things, they hurt Ahlul Bayt al-Nubuwah, the Prophet and his family line, but they didn't trouble the people too much, not like Uthman. So Uthman was like, how can you say an example of a leader these days? Uthman was like Qaddafi, let's say. So the people felt his oppression. Because they felt his oppression, they chose to rebel against him and they asked for Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salatu wasalam. So Amir al-Mu'mineen didn't want this leadership. He wanted the leadership appointed by Allah and by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. So they came to Amir al-Mu'mineen and they begged him, and he said he had no choice because there was no one else, and they literally begged him to take it, and he said okay, even though he knew what they were going to do. So he says, فَتَنَادَى بَعْضُ أَهْلِ عَسْكَرِي مِمَّنْ يُقَاتِلُ سَيْفُهُ مَعِي. Unfortunately, Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam, when you read Nahj al-Balagha, is full of Amir al-Mu'mineen's pains and sorrow and the lack of obedience from his followers. Very painful. مِمَّنْ يُقَاتِلُ سَيْفُهُ مَعِي فَقَالُوا يَا أَهْلَ الْإِسْلَامِ غُيِّرَتْ سُنَّةُ عُمَرٍ. Oh, these people that were going to rebel and start shouting, the people that exist in his own army would say, oh, people of Islam, the sunnah of Umar has been changed. And who is Umar? For his sunnah to be changed and for it to be such a great thing. This is Imam Ali alayhi salam. The person who Rasulullah, your prophet, if you respect your prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, said man kuntu mawlah fahadha aliyun mawlah. He didn't say man kuntu mawlah fahadha umarun mawlah fahadha aba bakrin mawlah fahadha uthman mawlah aliyun mawlah. And the opposers, everyone knows that this only came down on Imam Ali alayhi salam. Allahumma wali man walah wa adi man adah. Oh Allah, please be an enemy to anyone who was an enemy to Amir al-Mu'mineen. And please be an ally to anyone who was an ally to Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salatu wasalam. This tells you that Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salatu wasalam, he's the infallible one. He's the one who should carry on the successorship because he makes no mistakes. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with him and with the people who are with him, and he is against the people who are against him. This means that he is right. Just like the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, he makes no mistakes. Otherwise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cannot be with him at all times.
يا أهل الإسلام غيرت سنة عمر
ينهانا عن الصلاة في شهر رمضان تطوعا في جماعة. He bans us from doing our bid'ah prayer in the time of شهر رمضان. حتى خفت أن يثوروا في ناحية عسكري. He says, I'm afraid that these people are going to rebel, that they're going to do a complete rebellion. This little bit that we've got right now is going to disappear as well. These few people that obey me and the Shia here and there, and the people who follow me as a leader, even these people, they're all going to dissipate. So he says, for this reason, I didn't do it. حتى خفت أن يثوروا في ناحية عسكري. And then he says, بؤسي لما لقيت من هذه الأمة بعد نبيها من الفرقة وطاعة أئمة الضلال والدعاة إلى النار. He says, look what I have withstood from this nation after the death of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وآله. And this is very important for the people that say Amir Mumin عليه السلام did not talk about anyone in Nahj al-Balagha. He did not curse anyone or all the rest of it. He says, بؤسي لما لقيت من هذه الأمة بعد نبيها من الفرقة وطاعة أئمة الضلال. And the obedience of the imams of ضلال والدعاة إلى النار. He says, these people, Abu Bakr and Umar and Uthman, these are أئمة of ضلال. They guide people in the wrong direction. والدعاة إلى النار. They're guiding you straight to the pits, straight to the hellfires. So Abu Bakr, Umar and Uthman are أئمة يدعون إلى النار by Amir al-Mu'mineen عليه الصلاة's words in Nahj al-Balagha that everyone thankfully takes as a source. بؤسي لما لقيت من هذه الأمة بعد نبيها من الفرقة وطاعة أئمة الضلال والدعاة إلى النار. وأعظم من ذلك لو لم أعطي السهم ذوي القربى إلا من أمر الله بإعطائه الذين قال الله عز وجل واعلموا أن ما غنمتم من شيء فأن لله خمسه وللرسول ولذي القربى واليتامى والمساكين وابن السبيل كل هؤلاء منا خاصة إن كنتم آمنتم بالله وما أنزلنا على عبدنا يوم الفرقان يوم التقى الجمعان فنحن والله الذين عنا الله بذي القربى الذين قرنهم الله بنفسه وبرسوله صلى الله عليه وآله فقال تعالى ما أفاء الله على رسوله من أهل القرى فلله وللرسول ولذي القربى واليتامى والمساكين وابن السبيل كي لا يكون دولة بين الأغنياء منكم وما آتاكم الرسول فخذوه وما نهاكم عنه فانتهوا واتقوا الله في ظلم آل محمد إن الله شديد العقاب لمن ظلمهم رحمة منه لنا وغنى أغنانا الله به ووصى به نبيه صلى الله عليه وآله لأنه لم يجعل لنا في سهم الصدقة نصيبا وأكرم الله رسوله صلى الله عليه وآله وأكرمنا أهل البيت أن يطعمنا من أوساخ أيدي الناس فكذبوا الله وكذبوا رسوله وجحدوا كتاب الله الناطق بحقنا ومنعونا فرضا فرضه الله لنا ما لقي أهل بيت نبي من أمة ما لقينا بعد نبينا صلى الله عليه وآله. والله المستعان على من ظلمنا، ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم. ثم قال عليه السلام: معاشر شيعتي، اصبروا على عمل لا غنى بكم عن ثوابه، واصبروا عن عمل لا صبر لكم على عقابه. إنا وجدنا الصبر على طاعة الله عز وجل أهون من الصبر على عذاب الله. اعلموا أنكم في أجل محدود وأمل ممدود ونفس معدود، ولا بد للأجل أن يتناهى. سلام الله عليك يا أمير المؤمنين. وللأمل أن يطوى، وللنفس أن يحصى. ثم دمعت عيناه عليه السلام فقرأ: وإن عليكم لحافظين كراما كاتبين يعلمون ما تفعلون. صلى الله عليك يا أمير المؤمنين، صلى الله عليك يا أمير المؤمنين، صلى الله عليك يا أمير المؤمنين. ولعن الله أعداءك إلى يوم الدين. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. اللهم عجل فرج مولانا صاحب العصر والزمان، واجعلنا اللهم من القائمين بخدمته، ومن أصحابه وأنصاره، وقدامه وأقرب أوليائه في ذلك اليوم وفي كل يوم، برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين، وخير الغافرين، وخير الناظرين، وخير الساترين. وصل اللهم على خيرتك من خلقك محمد وآل محمد.